I should go with directly with my topic, root cause analysis in clinical biochemistry. Am I audible? If
just yes, give me sir, you are audible.
Great. Thank you. So we have. I go to any lab for the audit. They are more skeptical about this terminology. NC, so many. Okay, NC, we call it as non-conformity or non-conformance. Okay, these are actually, in literal terms, we can call it as deviation from normal. Okay, as per the ISO 15189, it is defined as non-fulfillment of a requirement. So what is required in that context? If it is not fulfilled, say some procedure has been documented, but it is not implemented properly, we can call it as non-fulfillment of a requirement or non-conformancy. Okay, it can be incident or accident. Incident means, it has a potential to cause harm, but it has not. So it is potential problem. Accident means the problem has already occurred. So errors are there, events or occurrences are there, which we call them as non-conformances. So all these non-conformances has to be dealt with. Okay, so as per the clause 4.9, ISO 15189-2012, it says that there must be a documented procedure to identify and manage these NCs in any aspect of the quality management system, though it is in any phase of the processes, pre-analytical, analytical, and post-analytical. And rest of the clauses, there are other clauses also, say 4.10, which says that we should do the RCA. This is 4.9 actually, where RCA is required for any non-conformancy or any deviation from normal. 4.10 says that corrective action has to be implemented. 4.11 says that you should have preventive action or proactive action. And 4.12 says there should be an continual improvement through all the processes. Say we should learn from our mistakes done previously. Okay, we should do corrective action by 4.10, preventive action by 4.11, and thereby we should do continual improvement in 4.12. These are all clause 4 management clause. Okay, so I'm dealt with 4.9 today only. So the RCA, root cause analysis. Say, I tell you, whenever I go in any lab now, so they do the root cause analysis for any error. Say, for example, one example I would like to share, that one fellow has fallen, okay, with a sample, bunch of samples, okay. So at that time, he has been warned that you should walk carefully, okay. So this was, say, 6 months back. And the same, and when I have audited that thing, then I have seen that the person walking on that floor was always having a wet area, okay, and that floor was having a wearing of those anti-slip material, okay. So that has not addressed, and after 6 months, that person has fall down again. Root cause analysis was not done at that time, and the person fall down, he had a serious injury, okay, and he has to take so many immunoglobulins and antibodies, okay. So the problem is we haven't addressed the issue completely, okay, while there was wet. Actually, the area was not covered with shell. Secondly, the anti-slip covering was torn. Okay, so these were two reasons. And thirdly, his boss was always ragging him. You are very slow. In that way, he has fall down. So there were three major background things which were playing the role in falling repeatedly for in that case. So the previously we haven't addressed that cause, so it has recurred again. So wherever I go to the lab, they do very superficial closure of any non-conformancy. Say if ICA's performance is filled in manually, okay, they do some transcription errors. Okay, the only error we or only solution they give, okay, we will do dual check, or will be done by the supervisor, will be done by only by quality manager, or training will be imparted. But these are not the root causes. We have to think beyond these superficial reasons. Okay, so, and we should not have a blame game, because NCs are most of the time used not for the quality improvement purposes, for the blame game purposes. So since the advent of patient safety movement since 90s, there has been a considerable culture change around how to manage these adverse events. The main shift has now, transformation has happened. It was previously individual punishment or individual training or imparting into superficial things. And now we have started to thinking towards system improvement. Okay. So, we are all farmers or having the background of village. We know if weed is growing in the farm, okay, we have to remove that weed. Okay, but we cannot pluck that weed only. We have to get to the root cause to get rid of the weed, to just to have better yield, because it's a financial loss if the weed will be there. Okay, we cannot treat these symptoms only. Weed is a symptom. Those roots are the major causes, okay, which refers here in this figure. So that's the reason the word root cause analysis is coming into play. So we have to go below the surface, obviously, okay, not treating the obvious causes. Say if a wound is there, pus is full of that, we cannot apply bandage over there, okay, only because there is a superficial wound. We have to check the pockets beneath to treat that particular. So I would say ironing of dirty laundry is not sufficient, okay, or I would say the putting the band-aid on the system is not enough. Okay, so these are some of the symptoms. They are not the root causes. If you can see, lack of training, it's not a root cause. Okay, human error is not a root cause. Procedures are not followed, or equipment is not working, or a poor performance of any specific guy. Okay, or process or method is not validated, or multiple raw material batches are there, or equipment in expired calibration. These are the symptoms. They are not the root causes. So we have to go beyond this. And but these symptoms are important, because they are the sources, or they provide the clues to the sources of root. Okay. So in previous slide, I have enumerated the symptoms, but the causes are this. The frequent causes are usually design. Okay, say design in the lab is such a way. I remember one story. Okay, one lab had mixing of all diagnosis of 25 specimens in histopath. Okay, complete specimen. When they have identified that one sample was mislabeled, and after that all the 24 samples are mislabeled. So there is a frame shift labeling of that of those all 25 samples. So the root cause was that. What was that? It was actually in that system or in that lab, the labels are applied in batches. The machine was not able to print on real-time basis any specimen identification or entry. The barcode is not generated on real-time basis. So individual barcode cannot be applied. They assemble the barcode and apply them. Okay, the importance of which was not implemented. Okay, so that has to be taken into account. Manufacturing, that is also one of the frequent cause. Supervision and management, change control. Okay, say for example, reference range change. Okay. I have seen so many labs suddenly they are doing method change and not implementing it in the report format. Obviously, reference range should be traceable to method one. Secondly, system, then it should be in your SOP also, and it should reflect in your report also, isn't it? So change control, the purchase and supplier, these are also a problem. Quality testing, documentation maintenance, training, employee performance, equipment, work environment, procedures and SOPs. These are very frequent ones, and these are usual suspects. I don't want to go into the details, but I would like to tell you the fact that you always have to consider underlying process science and engineering. Okay, you cannot be a doctor only. You have to be engineer if you want to survive, and if you want to do the root cause analysis, you have to learn the engineering also. So which is called as a root cause? Root cause is not training. Training, can you calculate it? Is it a specific thing? Criteria of a root cause, it should be specific actually. Means it should be applying to that reason. It should be measurable. It should be action oriented. It should be realistic. You cannot hypothetically say this might be the root cause. Okay, and it should be time constrained. These are five SMART principles of a root cause. If you identify a root cause, you measure it in this way, whether this is following the SMART principle or not. So whenever a root cause analysis has to be done, we have to define the problem. Einstein says, if I want to solve any problem, or say in our terms, identify the root cause of a non-conformancy, if I will be given 60 minutes to solve the problem, I will spend 55 minutes to identify the problem and 5 minutes to solve it. So you have to define and gather the data. Okay, this is most critical thing. The identify issues that contributed to the problem, then you have to find the root cause. And of course, after the root cause, you have to identify the correction, develop the solution or recommendations to effectively prevent such a problem in the future also. Implement it and again see whether this implementation has changed to your intended level or not, whether to ensure the effectiveness of change you have made or some elimination you have done. Okay, or elimination of that problem has been done. This is root cause analysis cycle. Okay, so if you won't be able to find any changes at the end of this cycle, you have to again go to the first step of identifying the root causes. Okay, so RCA is not a core. It's not a job. It's not a burden. It can be a fun. Okay. So, of course, by eliminating the root cause or identifying the root cause, you can save time and money. Okay, say in that case, if those 25 samples diagnostic mix-up has happened, okay, every diagnosis was spurious. Okay, normal has been given a cancer or something like that. Okay, you have to refund the money and listen to the clinician to any extent. So this slide says that your RCA should be documented. Your lab should have an SOP to define authorities and responsibility of performing RCA. So who is going to say this is an NC. What should be done in an NC? What protocol has to be followed to find the root cause? Okay, who will evaluate the significance of a NC, and who will decide that the investigations, which investigation has to be done, and who notifies the customer if at all we want to recall the reports or so, and who is responsible for authorizing the resumption of work after correcting it. So all these things has to be defined in the SOP itself. Okay. So, and in the process of RCA, we have to define who should be involved into the RCA analysis. Of course, say if it is a accession error, okay, I have to involve the accession team members, okay, because they are the groundwork members, okay, they know the actual process, okay, all those are involved into the process has to be has to be given the opportunity, or they should lead in participation of RC. They should suggest these are the possible possibilities or possible error which might be there responsible for the error. So employees closest to the work understand the vital information regarding workarounds and unsafe conditions, and they can pay special attention to deviation from standard workflow. Okay. And we have to define the time also, so because it is important to investigate the event as soon as possible. So if there are two types of NCs, which need immediate mitigation and which can be signed off. Okay, if immediate mitigation is required, then you have to do the correction first. Okay, immediate correction, say taking back the report, amending it and release it that way. Okay, or immediate halting of all these analyses that way. Okay, so that is required. And at the end of RCA process, you have to share the document to all the people in the lab. Okay, this is just like a post-mortem of whatever problem has occurred. Okay, you have to share that to win the confidence of your team member as well as being transparent. Okay, so there are tools in the RCA, say ICAS and IQC outlier. This is not the only job of RCA. There are so many things which do happen, errors. So how to do the RCA is really funny job. Okay, so many tools in RCA. Say 5 whys are there. Say in the previous session, somebody asked the calibration frequency. Okay, so when to do the calibration? Okay, the answer lies in here in the tools of RCA. Okay, what measures we have to do in IQC or ICAS outlier? There are tools in RCA. 5 whys are there. Then fishbone or Ishikawa diagram is there. Pareto chart is there. Then graphs are there. We will go through one by one. COSMAP means 5 whys. Say it's a visual explanation of why an event occurred. Okay, you have to ask, the crux is you have to ask at least 5 times why. This is a thumb rule. You have to ask at least 5 whys. Okay, say previous example is there. So labeling error has happened, then why? Then again, the label was, the garbling has happened, or probably frame sheet has happened. Why? Because it was batch generation. Why? Because machine was not capable of doing that, or it was a manual error. Why? Manual, then training was given or not. Why? So you have to ask why, unless and until you will get the root cause. Okay, so the cause map creates connection between individual cause and effect relationship to help build the narrative. Okay, so this is very simple technique required, and form is not required, nothing is required. Most of the time I have seen the ICAS outlier, we have outlier checklist. Okay, say they are doing so many questions they are asking, and we get an answer yes or no, and by that we do the RCA. That is good, not a problem. But this is one of the way we have to do the cause mapping. And it is this cause mapping is best used when tackling a simple RC. Five whys, you have to ask only. Okay, so this is an example I have already narrated. Okay, frameshift. So one sample, this is missed. So there is complete frame shift. Okay, so you have to ask why, like this. Say there is diagnostic mix-up. So why? Because 25 specimens mislabeled. Why? Because frame shift error. Why? Because technology selected wrong level. Why? It is either manual process or human error. So these are the four errors at the end. On the left side, you will get the LIS incapable of printing labels in real time. There was a distraction. Say that lab was having is in the midst of the all the other departments. So there was a distraction to the technologist. That's why he probably done the mistake, or probably he was having a pressure. Okay, he was the only person doing that job in that particular shift. Okay, or he might be having a consecutive accession numbers visually similar. Okay, those barcodes were looking similar only, or probably he was doing giving training to somebody, so that could have caused the distraction. You have to identify those. So whenever an NC happens, you have to immediately start RCA, because such things, say for example, he was giving training at that time, or he was in the middle of something at that time, that recall of memories is lost when if we start RCA late. Okay, so another example is there. Say slide is mislabeled. Okay, why? Because the block number was transcribed incorrectly. That number. Okay, instead of 5, it is transcribed as 8. Why? Because the handwritten label was difficult to read. Handwritten, no? Okay, then why? The print was very small, slightly smudged. The technician was not able to distinguish the difference between 5 and 8. Okay, why? The lighting source was exactly behind the technician. He could not see that. Why? Because there isn't a dedicated light source for labeling only. Okay. So the solution was what? You should have a dedicated light source. You should not keep on saying ki training was insufficient, or he should be way more careful. Okay, this is not the right cause or root cause, isn't it? So dig out the phenomenon. Okay. Fishbone. This is very interesting. Okay, this is just like, I'll show you the figure. Okay, this is a problem, is a mouth of the fish. Okay, and bones of the fish are the areas. Okay, the 5 areas are man, machine, method, for 6M, you remember. Okay, these are the only areas which does the mistake. Man, machine, method, measurement or management, whatever. Mother nature means environment and material. Okay, these are 6 areas who does the mistake. Say this you have to identify where exactly the errors happen. Okay, so this type of diagram identifies all the potential processes and factors that could contribute to that problem. Okay, say ICAS outlier is there. I will show you again. ICAS outlier is a problem, correct? Okay, it might be because of man, okay, or method or material management. How? Say for example, material. Okay, so ICAS sample might have been processed late. Okay, it might not have been received at appropriate temperature. Say if it not have been reconstituted properly, it is man. Okay, so it might have shown some dust or floating material. Okay, next, it might not have been processed on with appropriate technology. Okay, say CRP, I have seen so many times, CRP, they are suddenly doing the method change with immunoturbidimetry and again immunonephelometry that way. So that has to be checked. So on which machine it has processed. Okay, say then related with method, which method they have employed, okay, ICAS outlier. Then we have to check to the machine whether the machine calibration was there or not correctly. Okay, whether the person who was performing that process was trained or not. Okay, so many things. On machine, whether the IQC was perfect on that day or not, isn't it? So all these possibilities has to be fall into these six buckets. Okay, this is buckets actually. Okay, so you have to do the brainstorming to find out all the reasons in these six sections, which are potential reasons for the problem to occur. Okay, this is called fishbone diagram. This is popularly been used by Ishikawa, okay, Japanese scientist. Okay, and they have been very successful identifying the culprits. Okay, I'll share you one simple example. Say for example, feedback. Feedback form is very important, na? As per the NABL, okay, feedback form has to be filled by the customers. But there might be errors. We could not get the enough feedbacks from the patients. Say, feedback form is usually available at the reception, isn't it? Or at the lab reception area, wherever. Okay, so, but they are not getting filled by the customers or by the patients or the relatives, isn't it? There might be many things, na? Say in the man, it might be miscommunication between the phlebotomy and the reception team. Okay, who should do that? Who should explain to the customers, isn't it? Or training is not given probably, or inadequate training or poor training is given for filling up the feedback form. Okay, or it might be a design, the form included in the system. Okay, the form of that feedback form is very clumsy, cannot be understood by the customer. Okay, or material, the copies are not enough, the print or the hard copies are not available at the desk. Okay, that could be a problem. Or environment, the customer cooperation is not there because there may not be availability of desk to write yes or no or some feedback comments. Okay, the customer cooperation is there. So this is how we have to do the RCA, isn't it? Fine. Another thing is labeling error. I told you now. Okay, the labeling errors are there. So in these 5-6 categories, buckets, what are the possible errors? We have to brainstorm this. And this Ishikawa method, I tell you, it is good in the way that it helps you identify the root causes beyond the scope or beyond the purview of the lab. Okay, there might be other reasons. And this is classical of, I would say, pre-analytical errors to identify, okay, this. Say, I told you, there are so many labs who are doing checklist. Okay, but the checklist is not enough. Say, checklist, instead of that checklist, we should implement for either 5 whys or Ishikawa. Why? Because the checklist is only addressing few important bullet points. Okay. But it doesn't help you to identify the do the RCA for specialized techniques. Say for example, HbA1c analysis. Okay, we cannot incorporate column reasons. The column is required now for HbA1c. The buffer system, or the stationary system, or the graph system, the calculation system. So the RCA for that. Different technology is different. Okay, for the photometry or immunology, it is different. Okay, so it differs from system to system. So applying one carpet checklist for all the technologies or for all the types of errors is not a sound phenomenon. Okay, so I hope you got this concept of fishbone technology. A fishbone tool for identification of all the causes. Okay. Third one is very interesting. Okay, now with 5Ys or Ishikawa technology, you got the idea that the major causes of the error, okay, are very few. Okay, say one company is there, say sales company. Okay, we are also into the say my lab is there, and I want other labs to send sample to me. Okay, say we are into say in B2B business. Okay, so I want other labs to send sample to me, but they are reluctant or they are denying samples sending to me. Okay, there might be 5-6 reasons, but there are one or two major reasons, okay, which are responsible for not getting the 80% of the total business. Okay, so I need to know which are the major causes which are responsible for that particular problem. Okay, so in Pareto principle, this is the principle. Okay, this customer satisfaction, I have taken an example like this. Okay, so there are 6 reasons of customer satisfaction. Okay, but the major problem is attitude of indifference with my customer support or with my sales member. Okay, so 20% of the people of the problem is responsible for 80% of the loss. You got it? So if I will do correction in 20%, I will get benefit of 80%. So this Pareto principle or Pareto analysis is very good. This is well understood, very easy to understand sort of way of doing the RCA. So I get those major problems in the system, which are, if we correct it, we will get the maximum benefit. Okay. And another method is brainstorming. Usually this brainstorming is done, say for example, any problem is arising. So we have to collect as many ideas as possible from all the participants with no criticism. Huh? Okay, no judgments. We should not laugh at somebody or say silly. Okay, we have to be creative, and we have to welcome all the ideas. We will discuss those ideas. We'll not criticize it. We'll not judge it. We'll not even groan or frown or laugh at the ideas. Okay, and based on the ideas, we build up the construction. Okay, and we write all the ideas in a flip chart, and we'll get a solution. Okay, and we prepare the diagram, and based on which we can capture so many information and get the major reasons which are responsible for the problem. Okay, so RCA in ICAS and IQC outlier, as I told you, the checklist is commonly the one which is followed by most of the labs. Okay, and based on that, we can define where the error is occurring, say in it is pre-analytical, analytical, or post-analytical. Okay, we have to use the specific tool for the RCA. So based on the problem, we have to choose the tool, whether it should be 5Ys or cause map or the fishbone diagram. And of course, we have to look into the 6 M's to find out all the causes, all the potential causes of So this is the way we have to fill in the CAPA form, corrective and preventive action. Say if ICAS outlier is there, okay, what do we write? We write the ICAS outlier, the parameter, the method, isn't it? Okay, at what concentration, whether 5 samples are there, which concentration has affected, whether low or high, isn't it? So based on that, we have to map. Here the 5Y principle is used. Okay, So why the problem has occurred, okay, whether it is related with man, machine, method, whether it is related with management, okay, or with the environment or material, okay, then based on the root causes, at the end of 5Y or at the end of doing the Ishikawa or any other tool, we definitely get the root cause, and we have to and that root cause has to be specific. As I told you, it should be falling into a SMART principle. Okay, then only we can call this as a root cause. Okay, and we are based on that root cause, we have to implement the corrective action. We have to implement the preventive action, and then we do the continual improvement. Okay, so all the responsibilities has to be fixed. Who is doing root cause analysis? Who is proposing that NC? Who is doing the corrective action? Who is doing that preventive action? All has to be documented. Okay, and who is closing that NC? Of course, there is a form NAF4 in NABL which is to be filled for any non-conformances encountered. Okay, so at the end, I would like to tell you there are pitfalls of RCA. So not understanding the problem, or therefore not defining it correctly, is also a problem with RCA. If we do one sort of checklist only, okay, we may not go beyond that. And say, I will tell you, so many labs are saying ki this is random error. Okay, but have you checked all the aspects? Okay, before call, random error is a diagnosis by exclusion, isn't it? Okay, so you have to be sure that other things are not there contributing to the particular error. Okay, there is no error in the manpower, no dilution error, no training error, or no calibration problem. There is no change in the principle, change in the method, no error in the temperature at that time. Okay, the machine calibration was good, the IQC was good at that point. Okay, the pre-analytical error was not there, say a receipt of sample. Okay, the I would say material, the temperature of the reagent was proper, say if it is ELISA. Okay, we have to get that all reagents at room temperature, then perform the ELISA, or putting in the reagent vials inside, it has to be at appropriate temperature. Then the environmental temperature was proper. Say if environment temperature is not correct, the HPLC will show peak shift. Okay, so we'll get different integration. Okay, so you have to identify all the errors which can happen in the 6 buckets. Okay, then only you can call this as a random error. Okay, second problem is RCA is done by the senior staff member, quality manager only. I don't know why. It has to be done by the ground staff worker. Okay, so it is the responsibility of a technician to do the RCA. Okay, whatever training is required, you have to give the training to the person. Okay, what all things he has to check. Okay, then you the quality manager can monitor the activities done in the RCA. Okay, so not asking for help is not good for RCA. Okay, not considering all possible failure modes or causes, that is also a big challenge. Not identifying all root causes, so you have to go beyond the problems to check. Okay, say I'm giving you a simple example of transcription error while putting in the values, ICAS values. Okay, so what are the errors? Okay, I'm sure the treatment, a special treatment is given for ICAS samples. Okay, since this is a regulatory requirement for any lab to get the NABL accreditation. Okay, so we do give special importance. Okay, I do admit, I also do the same. Okay, it should be treated like a routine sample. It should be a complete blinding sample, ideally. Okay, but it is not in reality. Okay, so transcription error do happen. So there are so many things. We write incorrect method, we write incorrect unit, we write decimal errors, okay, or we write incorrect results for different samples altogether. Okay, do you know at the end of ICAS submission, when the results come, we do review that. At the end of that, we get to know where do we stand exactly in the context of our peer. Say if one lab is doing alkaline phosphatase on Beckman, okay, Beckman, as Mamta ma'am has said, there are many methods with P5P, without P5P, isn't it? So we have to choose the right one, okay, to get the right peer. Otherwise we will be the outlier. I have seen so many funny things. People are so senior, but they don't understand any machine, whether the principal Lifotronic one. I recently audited one lab wherein the machine was Lifotronic. Clear cut, it was a HPLC machine, okay, for HB variant analysis. He has written HB electrophoresis. Yeah. So obviously there would be outlier. So what should you do? You cannot say training will be imparted, isn't it? Okay. You have to understand how the system should operate, isn't it? Then runaway test and analysis. I tell you, this is very dangerous. Runaway test and analysis. For RCA, we do so many things unnecessarily. Okay, if outlier is there, okay, we do as previously somebody said ki. Somebody does calibration directly, but Mamta has already nicely told calibration is the last thing to do. Okay, before that you have to search so many things, isn't it? Okay, so check out all the areas where the potential errors can happen. Okay, then go for saying either random error or do the calibration. Calibration is also required when there is a repeated sort of error. Okay, fine. Adopting a remove or replace mentality. This is very dangerous. Okay, say I recently came across one incidence when fellow has completely replaced the machine only because he was showing that machine was showing erroneous error in bilirubin. Then when we checked that sample, he called me whether to replace this or not. I have already placed the order for different technology machine. But when I checked, bilirubin was out continuously, but other parameters were working fine. I told there must be some error in the bilirubin itself. Okay, because participation, if you can see, all the outliers are in bilirubin only. Okay, there must be a problem with bilirubin, isn't it? So you check it out. But he told me my calibration is also perfect. I have done so many things. Now I have to replace it. But bilirubin, he has kept the calibrator outside the, or I would say not in a recommended way. So handling of QC material or calibrators, okay, was not appropriate. So aliquoting he has done, and bilirubin has deteriorated, and it showed that the calibrator has deteriorated, and accordingly the calibration deteriorated, systemic error happened. Okay, so you cannot do this by adopting remove replace mentality. And this silver bullet theory, this is very dangerous. Do you know this meaning? If our time is good, okay, any improvement methodology or corrective action we employ, okay, it gives you the results. Okay, that is called silver bullet theory. If your time is good, everything working fine for you. Okay, but that is not true, isn't it? So that is also dangerous thing to do. Say in fishbone, I have done say correction in management, okay, or material, okay, which is not actually related or not actually related with the correction, but it has given the result. Okay, maybe because the time was good. Okay, so that is called silver bullet theory. This is not correct. This is not hold true for technical things, but non-technical things. Okay. Returning the part or product without analysis. Say HPLC column, we replace it number of times, but there was no problem with the column. There might be problem in the buffer. There might be problem in the sample. Okay. There might be problem with the pump. Okay, so you have to disintegrate the problem, okay, and check all the areas whether it is really that problem and or not. Okay, so that RCA is very important. Failing to follow through, jumping to conclusion. This is very dangerous. Okay, tearing a system apart without a plan. Okay, these are all some of the pitfalls of RCA. So in the summary, I would like to conclude that root cause analysis is a method to focus our efforts on the true root causes of escapes so that we truly prevent them their reoccurrence. Okay, so timely corrective preventive action will help you for reoccurrence of same problem. Okay, in NABL it is said ki if same NCs will be there in the next audit, okay, you will not get the accreditation. Okay, so reoccurrence of a problem is not a good thing, isn't it? So root cause analysis, that's why it is important. Okay, so root cause analysis helps us reduce turnbacks and frustration, maintain customer satisfaction, and reduce the cost significantly. Okay, so the reanalysis, changing of reagents, recalibration, so many things can be avoided by doing the appropriate root cause analysis. Okay, so treat every problem, every NC is an opportunity for quality improvement. Okay, so it contains the information which is needed for you to eliminate the problem. So foresee that, see to it. And to identify the root cause, we have to ask why over and over again, okay, until we reach to the root cause. So, thank you very much.